Mark Rogers TV with you to talk some Memphis football with the Tigers at 7-0 and 3-0 in the American Athletic Conference. We bring in John Maddox of the Tigers Tonight podcast to help us out with this Memphis football team. Of course, coming off that huge victory that caught the nation's attention against Ole Miss a couple of weeks ago, John. So let's start there because that's obviously the landmark win for this program going back several years, but pertaining to this football season in terms of establishing legitimate national contention. So just your observations of how well the team played, especially considering they got into a hole early in the game as a big underdog.
Well, you know, I thought it was a very interesting game, and you know, this is going to sound crazy considering we fell behind 14-0, but when Mississippi called the trick play on the second play from scrimmage, I told my buddy I was sitting with, I was like, they're scared, because that's how typically teams like Memphis have to play teams from the SEC. Is we have to, you know, I call it the smoke and mirrors approach. We have to throw trick plays and you know, a lot of deception. But frankly, we lined up and we beat Ole Miss, and that's something we haven't done. You know, as you mentioned, we haven't beaten a ranked team since 96, and you know, we beat Mississippi down there in 04. And that was the last time we really just kind of lined up and we punched them in the mouth. And you bring up a great point. It's kind of been our MO this year. We've fallen behind six times in games, and we fell in quite a hole against Ole Miss. But, you know, the offense is just so good. It is almost impossible to stop for multiple drives. You may get a stop here and a stop there, but it's just when we get rolling and we get the running game moving, and that was the big thing that impressed me, frankly, was that last drive of the game where we held the ball for 16 plays, I think it was 70 yards, and held the ball for almost 8 minutes. And that's how Coach Fuente wants to win games. And then, you know, we follow that up with going out to Tulsa, a very game Tulsa team, and, you know, they just don't have the bodies yet, and they kind of hurt themselves the way they play so fast. But we put up 66 points, second most in the modern era. Behind in 1968, we put 69 on Louisville. That was a Lee Corso coached Louisville football team. It's our highest point total ever. So, you know, we have our deficiencies defensively, and we have our deficiencies in the penalty department. But I think our offense just trumps everything. You know, Paxton Lynch has gone from a 6'7 lanky kid that nobody wanted to, you know, I think Mel Kiper's got him 9th or 10th now on the big board, and he's I think if he continues his play, he'll end up the year in New York for the Heisman ceremony. I don't think he'll win it, but I definitely think he'll end up with an invite.
Yeah, John, you took me in the direction that I was headed, because I think I'm like a lot of college football fans and people that cover college football. I can't decide who to watch on Saturday. Unfortunately, there's like 15 games I want to see. Fortunately, Paxton Lynch in Memphis has been able to schedule a number of games on Thursday night, so we've been able to see the Cincinnati game in particular. Of course, the Ole Miss game was probably the best game at that time slot. And you mentioned the game against Tulsa, 66-42, and that was played, I believe, on a Thursday night as well. So we got to see Paxton Lynch. But what makes this kid so special in addition to the frame and the tangibles?
Well, I think it's been his growth as a player. You know, we talked at length on the podcast last week about, you know, him possibly being a top 10 pick, which was unfathomable 2 years ago. But, you know, if you watch his motion, his mechanics, are much tighter. He gets rid of the ball extremely fast, and 99 out of 100 times he makes good decisions. He is in the last two games, I think, made two decisions that were very questionable. But other than that, he makes plays with his feet. He is going to be in the NFL the type of player. He'll be kind of like Roethlisberger, where he's able to extend plays. But, you know, he is not going to be able to run, and we haven't run him tremendously this year, which is really funny, because at the beginning of the year, all Coach Fuente said is, oh, yeah, you know, Paxton put on 30 pounds, and we're going to use him more in the running game, and blah, 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 blah. Well, we barely used him in the running game, some option stuff and a few draws here and there, but he's just – his mechanics are sound, and he has a little bit of a chip on his shoulder with the – whole, you know, coming out of Florida, and he didn't get any offers from Florida, Florida State, Miami, any of those guys. You know, and with the exception of Florida State, you know, you ask Jim McElwain if he wouldn't mind having Paxton Lynch under center, or formerly Al Golden, if he wouldn't mind having Paxton Lynch. And I think that's helped him a lot. But as I heard somebody talk about this morning, it's also really helped keep him grounded and keep him focused and not let, because it's really easy when nobody's watching you to be great. But when the lights come on and people start taking notice, how do you handle that success as well? And he's frankly handled it as well as could be expected, probably better than I expected. But as I'm sure we'll talk about in a little bit, the proof's about to be in the pudding as the schedule definitely ramps up here towards the end of the year.
Yeah, and before we get to the schedule, John, it's sometimes fortunate, sometimes unfortunate, depending on the performance of the team overall. The quarterback gets too much credit, gets too much blame. So that's what college football fans, unless they really dig deep, know about the Memphis Tigers. Paxton Lynch. We see that Dorland Dorsey has ran for 138 yards, but you basically have a running back by committee, at least have to this point. A lot of different guys get the football. A couple of wide receivers and Anthony Miller and Mose Frazier, who have been productive for you. Defensively, yeah, the numbers don't speak to too much production on defense. 110th in total defense, 81st in scoring. But who are some of those other guys that if Memphis, if anybody out there is turning on the Memphis Tigers for the first time, that they'll want to look out for?
Well, on the offensive side of the ball, I think you mentioned it. And the funny thing about Anthony and Mose and Alan Cross, three of our Alan Cross, our tight end, who has the most touchdown receptions in school history for a tight end. The great thing about those three guys, all walk-ons. They all walked on to the program. And, you know, Anthony Miller had his coming out party against Mississippi. So if we can get Sam Kraft healthy, he's another offensive weapon that we have. He's been a little banged up and a little dinged up and just hasn't quite been himself this year. On the other side of the ball, you know, defensively, as you said, it's kind of hard to say, hey, there's some good players over there. But, you know, really, if you break our defense down, if you look at our problems, we have played the first, fourth, sixth, eighth, and 11th passing offense in the country this year. So that tends to lead itself to some of the problems. Now, we've had back, you know, breakdowns on the back end, but on defense, you've got guys like Jackson Dillon, who is a kind of one of those hybrid linebacker defensive ends who's just motor never stops, just he seems to always be around the ball. But Gerard Avery, a linebacker by trade from Grenada, Mississippi, has really stepped up, in my opinion, this year and really is, you know, starting to make a name for himself. I think he had 8 tackles in the game against Tulsa, but it was just one of those things where he was everywhere. It seemed like, you know, everywhere the ball was, there was Gerard Avery. So, you know, those are a couple guys. And then, you know, offensively, the offensive line has been solid. You know, guys like Taylor Fallon and those guys, Ryan Mack, I mean, they've just held it down. And Tyler Usselton and Chris Roberson, who's moved in the starting lineup, you know, they've kept Paxton upright. And, you know, Jamarius Henderson, who was a little banged up, had 122 yards against Tulsa. And as you said, that's kind of how we're going to do it on offense from the running back position, is we've got 3 or 4 guys that could start just about anywhere they went. So we can, you know, Jarvis Cooper was a little banged up Friday night against Tulsa, so we rested him. And, you know, that gave Dorland, who's finally, it seems like he's back from the knee injury he suffered last year against Mississippi. And Jamarius Henderson's a freshman, and I thought it was great during the game. Jamarius fumbled, and the very next possession, Tulsa goes 3 and out. The very next possession, Justin hands in the ball again 3 straight times. So, you know, I think that we have a lot of, I don't want to say no names on offense outside of Paxton, but we have a lot of just solid guys that are just – playing well in the running back position. We're so deep. We can hit you so many different ways, so many different styles. It will probably, by next year, it'll be Jamarius Henderson's job, but Dorsey has been great coming back. He's kind of that contrast of physical, but he's also shifty, and Cooper is just a load to bring down, and Henderson is a nice balance of those two. So, you know, it's all around team effort. You know, Paxton definitely drives the bus, but you know, everybody that's riding on that bus plays a part in it as well.
Hey, John, you brought up
Coach Fuente.
Hopefully we don't have to go in there all of a sudden. Just in regards to what he brings to the table, because you've got your technicians, you got your strategists on the sideline who know the game and coach it well. From that standpoint, you have your program building coaches, and then you have your coaches, and not to discount his ability in those two areas, but you have your coaches that connect with the players and who display a genuine involvement, engagement, connection to the players. And it seems as though he has that with his team.
He does. He has a unique ability to connect with these guys, and you know, they have bought in. They are buying into what he's saying because, you know, he's a very smart guy. He came from Gary Patterson's system, of course. So there's nothing new under the sun, and it's helpful for kids when they see something happen that he says was going to happen. You know, that guy was going to run a go route on you, and what happened on the next play? You ran a go route and you didn't get your hips turned and you got beat deep for a touchdown. But he's also, I think he is that program builder, and that, look, we, you know, our recruiting classes have been mid 70s, low 80s. You know, I just said the walk-on program. I mean, you know, Paxton, I mean, he's a guy that knows how to find the right guys to fit what he wants to do, which is throw to score and run to win. So, you know, that's what he said the day he was hired, was that's how we were going to play. And, you know, he doesn't BS, and he doesn't do a lot of coach speak, and he does a really great job of making the kids understand, you know, what's going to happen. And even if we start slow, which we have, you know, in almost every game this year, this staff does such a good job, and it's top to bottom. It's, you know, him, and it's Daryl Dickey, the offensive coordinator, Brad Cornelianson, the quarterback coach, Galen Scott, the defensive coordinator. They do just such a good job of in-game adjustments, which is what a lot of staffs, as odd as it sounds, struggle with. They coaches get what I call smartest guy in the room syndrome, and we're going to run the football. We're going to run the football. Well, if the defense is putting eight in the box, you can't keep just running the football. And Justin says, well, that's fine. Put eight in the box, and we'll just throw it over top of you. So that's what I think we do better probably than a lot of staffs in this conference is, you know, we just adjust. And we, you know, if you're going to let us throw all day, we'll throw. And if you're going to let us run all day, we'll run. I mean, it really doesn't matter to us. And defensively, fine, you want to come out and you want to miss direction, we'll just drop guys off. Or you want to come out and hit quick passes, we'll come up and we'll guard. I mean, so, you know, it's a lot of that. And Justin is a program builder. He knows how to get guys. Look, when he got here, there were 54 players on scholarship. So, you know, he's done something right. He goes out and he gets two-star guys and guys with no stars and negative two-star guys, and he makes them into superstars.
John Maddox joining us from Tigers Tonight podcast. John, I was not a fan of the BCS. I'm not a huge fan of the college football playoff. I think it's a better system just because it affords two other worthy teams of a chance to win a national championship. But obviously the big fault in it is that you have, even if you're just a power five focused guy, you're trying to fit five teams into four slots, in my estimation. In addition to that, we've got the wild cards of Notre Dame, and we have the wild cards of the group of five. Regardless of the season, we have teams out there that are tremendous football teams that have little to no chance of competing for a national championship. So I would love to see this system blown up to a certain extent. It's not going to blow up the system, but in regards to devaluing the system, although I think the College Football Playoff Committee does a tremendous job, I think they work their butts off to try to get this right. It's just impossible to get right. There's not enough slots. So we've got Memphis, we've got Temple, and we've got Houston, three undefeated football teams. Now, that's going to work itself out in regards to them playing each other and also playing each other for a conference championship game. I would love to see one of them run the table. And of course, you want it to be the Memphis Tigers, but I would love to see one of them run the table, especially since we've got wins over Penn State. Not a great football team, but still a quality win. Of course, the Ole Miss win, and possibly we'll see what Temple does with Notre Dame. Houston defeating Louisville as well, a decent ACC team. So just your thoughts about Memphis's schedule down the road. They've got the two toughies at Houston and at Temple coming up, and also just the addition of American Athletic Conference into the discussion this season.
Yeah, it's been nice, and you know, we knew we were going to have a good team this year, and I told everybody on our first Tigers Night podcast that Temple was going to be very good this year, and I thought Houston would be pretty good. I had no idea that on October 30th we would be sitting here and all three of us would be undefeated, you know, and a team that kind of gets left out of the talk. Navy is sitting there at 6-1. So, you know, after what should be a decent chance for a win tomorrow against Tulane at home, Memphis has Navy, Houston, and Temple back to back to back, just as as murderous of a row as you can have in this league. And, you know, we got to talking and the other day, and if Alabama, and we'll just use them for instance, because everybody knows them. If Alabama were to run the table and win the SEC championship game, they will probably play one more ranked team the entire way. Memphis, should they run the table and win the AAC, will play at least two, maybe three more ranked teams before the end of the year. So, you know, that's not to say Memphis is as good as Alabama. That's not what this is about. But it shows the balance that the top half of this league has had. Now, the problem with the AAC is the problem with the Mountain West, the problem with the MAC, the problem with Conference USA. The bottom is so bad that, you know, UConn and UCF is winless on the year and Tulane is not very good. And, you know, so you've got all this kind of dead weight at the bottom and the conference is top heavy. So, you know, and Tulsa and SMU are kind of the only two teams in the middle. So it is a good chance, I think, over these next 4 weeks for us to kind of, we'll work it out. And as far as it relates to the playoff, anything short of 8 is unfair because, you know, why should Memphis have to, you know, the difference is, can Memphis make the college football playoff? Yes, there is a scenario, a doomsday scenario, where it comes down, let's say Mississippi wins out and Memphis wins out. So how are you going to put Ole Miss in the college football playoff when they got not just, you know, we didn't flukely beat Ole Miss. We lined up and we dominated that game. So how does that play out? And it will be, Dan Walken, USA Today, wrote a great article the other day. It will be interesting to see how on Tuesday night. Tuesday night will tell the tale because Tuesday night's the first night of the college football rankings, playoff rankings. So we will see what they do with Memphis because, you know, we're a 32-point favorite tomorrow. I'm pretty sure we're going to win tomorrow. We're going to be sitting there with 8-0 with wins over, you know, Mississippi. And one that gets overlooked that's going to end up being a great win by the end of the year. We beat a very good Bowling Green team on the road. So we've got a couple of really good wins. Now, you look at Houston, and I'm not here to poor mouth our opponents coming up. Houston has beaten no one with a winning record. So that win over Louisville we'll see where it is at the end of the year. You know, Temple, if they run the table, they will have beaten probably 12th or 13th ranked Memphis and Penn State, as you said, and then they've got 10th ranked Notre Dame coming up tomorrow. So, you know, should one of the three of us run the table, I don't think we can get to the playoff, but I think we can make it extremely interesting. But again, you know, if another team, you know, if it's a two-loss Pac-12 team, how do they handle that? You know, Baylor, you know, they're probably going to slip losing Seth Russell. So now TCU can't afford to slip up. So, you know, I just tell everybody all the time that talks about this kind of stuff, let's just go out and win games. And at the end of the year, let's count them up, how many ever we got on the left versus how many on the right, and let the chips fall where they may. But, you know, I agree with your point that, you know, people hated the BCS and you know, whatever. It was not fair. Well, this is even more unfair in if you look at it, because a team like Memphis, we have to go undefeated, but we also have to schedule hard teams. You know, we can't go out and go undefeated like Marshall almost did last year. We have to go out and schedule Ole Miss, or we have to go schedule and go to Bowling Green. And then in our league, we've got Navy, Houston, Temple. I mean, so we have to make it so difficult on ourselves that the chances of us going undefeated is much less. You just have to have everything kind of fall in place for you. So, you know, there's a scenario or two where we can get to the playoff, but, you know, I think realistically Memphis fans would just be ecstatic if we ran the table and ended up in one of the contract bowls. I mean, would we love to get in the playoff? Sure. But, you know, I think that most of us understand that that's just not real, very realistic to happen.
Yeah, so much would have to fall. But right. In regards to that direct Ole Miss comparison, that's fascinating. I don't think the Rebels are going to run the table, but if they do and win the SEC, and that's two losses, and there's the one out-of-conference loss to Memphis, and it's a direct comparison against a Memphis team that has gone undefeated, that would be fascinating to see how that would shake out. I know my opinion would be the direct comparison, especially with no losses versus two losses, but I don't think the College Football Playoff Committee would necessarily look at it like that. But I like these things to be sorted out a little bit more objectively than rather, we think the SEC champion or fill in the blank has to be there. But it's fascinating, and it's going to work itself out. And obviously these teams, let me correct myself. I'm not one of those that believe it's going to work itself out, and we always come out with the best two or the best four. But in regards to the American Athletic Conference, that will work itself out because they all play and will play in a championship game as well. So good stuff. John Maddox joining us from Tigers Tonight podcast. John, it's always a good discussion. I learn a ton during these talks. Thank you, sir.
Awesome. Thanks for having me.